Hey, cinephile, this one's for you. Your love of film allows us to do what we do. If you want to support us, the best way to do so is to hit that subscribe button. From Spotify to Apple to our video versions on YouTube, subscribing matters. Feel really compelled? Well, we want to hear from you. Have a burning question? An indie filmmaker we need to interview or a film we need to know about? Think you can make us laugh on the air? Drop us a comment or a review.
Hey everyone, welcome to another Fandor video podcast. My name's Hooman with the great Chris Kelly.
Hey, who?
How are you, Chris?
All right, doing great. And we are joined as always by the
You guys really are great. He is a great Chris. You're the great Hooman too.
Thank you so much, Brent.
This lots, is our lots of greatness here.
It's our incredible number.
Including
Brent.
The guests. Talking about the guests.
All right.
We all buttered each other up. Let's talk to our guests.
Right. Welcome, Georgette Angelos and Chris. Chesson. Did I say that right?
Chesson. Close. It goes all different ways.
All right. Well, you guys have the Boston George docuseries. First of all, tell us a little bit about yourselves. Tell us who Boston George is and how this project came about.
Sure. I can kick it off because luckily me and Chris got to work together. So our streamline of consciousness, I guess, for this project kind of kicked it off with each other. I was the head of production for Snoop Dogg's company, Mary Jane, which was a media label that's based out of Los Angeles. And me and Chris had the pleasure of working together on a few different projects that led to one phone call that was, do you know who George Young is? I was working at a cannabis conference where there was TED Talks going on with Snoop and a lot of our associates and George was there signing autographs. So they said, hey, Georgette, you want to come meet George Young, who the movie Blow is based on? And I was like, of course, you know, that's a no-brainer. And me and George got to talk, and we had this really funny exchange, which is a pretty normal ordeal whenever you have the opportunity to cross paths with George. And that led to a phone call that happened maybe a week or two later. That was, hey, George is looking to produce a docuseries on his life while he still has the time to. Do you know anyone who'd want to do it? And without hesitation, crazy to think back now, I do. I would love to. And me and Chris had loved working with each other so much on our previous projects, again, through the under the Mary Jane umbrella, that I gave him a call first and said, you know, you kind of produce the same way that I do. You have this, you know, say yes, ask questions later mentality. And that's pretty much exactly what happened. So the journey pretty much started right then and there that day.
And so tell us who Boston George is.
Boston George is opposite of what you would think of when you think of smugglers. He was, you know, one of the best people that I've ever had the pleasure of talking to. Very intellectual, very funny, a little bit difficult at times, but you know, that's it. It wasn't about what he did in the past. He had a hard time kind of opening up. He started out just regurgitating the same stories that you already knew. And it took a minute for him to kind of open up. But once he did, he was just a treasure of stories. And like the author of the book, Bruce Porter, said, he just had perfect recall. He had just great memories. He knew everyone. Everybody knew him. And again, just very intellectual. You could talk to him about anything. It wasn't, we weren't there about drug smuggling aspects. We were there about, you know, his life, his music, his travel, his friends, which he made many of.
So just to clarify, Boston George is the guy who Pablo Escobar contracted to distribute cocaine in the United States in the 70s. And 75% of all cocaine in America in the 70s came to this country because of Boston George, correct?
Yes, correct.
Wonderful. All right, you mentioned difficult. I want to hear the stories. What was the most difficult thing about working with Boston George?
How difficult was
it? I mean, yeah. If you can just take, it was a 74-year-old man at the time who came out of a 25-year prison sentence. You know, it got dumbed down to 22, but at that point, there's really a very thin line that's drawn, you know? So he got out, and crazy enough, it was just kind of still drugs, sex, rock and roll mentality. Nothing had really changed. It's almost like time had stopped. And he loves his scotch. He loves smoking Camel non-filters, and it was a whole lot of that. But we were blessed because he was put on probation at first, and then the probation got broken, I guess you could say, because he traveled out of the county without letting his probation officer at the time know. On top of the fact that he got, you know, he would be talked to multiple times, and he was heavily intoxicated. So the next time he was incarcerated for a very short stint, which is when we were already involved in his lives, he wasn't drinking, but also, you know, before we would get with him and when we would drop him off, it was kind of an up in the air thing. But he is an outlaw. I mean, there is no stopping that at all. There was no stopping that train whatsoever. So the kind of FU mentality, whether he was drinking or not, was happening. I mean, it was like, you said up, he said down, we said go, he said stop. And it was a non-stop of that all the time. But luckily, just how Chris said, you know, it was almost like he had been taken advantage of so many times and that he didn't know who to trust or whatever. So once we kind of got him out of that beaten down mentality, he had a lot of faith in us and he trusted us a lot. So don't get me wrong, it was a headache the entire time. But at some point it did dumb down, and we kind of, you know, we'd bargain with him to not drink before filming, you know, if we let him, you know, do this, or if we, you know, all right, we'll get you a lobster dinner after we're done filming, just for fun. We'll take you out to a nice dinner, it'll be good. And just don't drink before we film. And he would listen to us kind of. And I think that he was like that sneaky kid mentality where his parents are telling him not to do something and maybe he would go sneak off and do it just in case, you know, just to make sure he still had that edge. But
I would imagine capturing some of that was exactly what you wanted for the series. Like, you know, so yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. What the actual documentary isn't just about his past. We dive into what his life was at that moment, the difficulties, the stuff he had with his family, dealing with parole officers, having to go to AA class. You know, as Georgette said, day one of our filming, he was sentenced back to 8 months in prison at 75. And so we were just put on hold for 8 months. Luckily, we got some prison interviews, but it was, you know, it was that kind of, you know, whirlwind experience that it just always seemed, it was like the curse of the George. There was always something, but we mixed in the reality of him not having money, of him having to live with his stepdaughter, about him when he had to move out, not having a home, not being able to, without money, without a reference, without this, he was trying to pull it off in Southern California and then trying to find something he could afford. So he didn't have any money. So we definitely showcased what his life was like, you know, once he got out as well. We're not just talking about past.
Did you think the project would die when he got sentenced back to prison? Were you worried about that?
It was a very hectic day, as you can well imagine, because we had already had all of our crew and our flight set up. So we were going no matter what. We didn't know what was going to come to it. And I kind of snuck off when we were at lunch and went over to the jail. And I talked with the lieutenant who was on that day. And, you know, I just kind of gave him this talk like, hey, listen, we just got up here, this. And he said, I'll let you have the room with him for an hour. And that was through glass. But once that happened, that little, of course, we had the Georgisms that happened, but then we would have the good juju that happened right after. So no matter what, every time we were kind of beat down, we'd rise up from the ashes and pretty much a, you know, 6 to 12 hour time period. So we never really gave up.
let's talk about the movie Blow.
Sure.
Which is based on Boston George's life, Johnny Depp and Penelope Cruz. How accurate is that film?
I think it's fairly accurate. I think that there are some of the aspects that no matter what film, when it's based on a true story, is going to be Hollywoodized.
So,
you know, you have to.
Did his mom and his wife actually really betray him?
Yes.
Yes.
Wow. Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. There was a lot to it that, you know, some of the other details, you know, he went to prison multiple times. One time, you know, he was sentenced for marijuana for this 25 years, cut down to 22. It wasn't cocaine. Now, he was busted for cocaine. he got 60 years, but also got out of jail in 5 years for that, because Pablo told him he had to testify against Carlos later. So he testified. He had 60 years, got out, and he said, screw it, and did it again.
Jeez. Oh, there's the way the Johnny Depp movie ends is pretty tragic and sad. Did George ever see his daughter that he had with Penelope Cruz, the Johnny Depp Penelope? Did he ever see her before he died? Did they ever reconcile?
When he first got out of prison, before me and Chris came in contact with him, Christina actually was who he was living with. And that's who was kind of bringing him around on these tours, if you will, to sign autographs and whatnot. And that's when the slope started getting relatively slippery, and then they cut ties again. So he did spend about a year of time, maybe a little bit less than that, with her. But it just went south. I mean, it was not a good scene. It wasn't a good scene from at least what we picked up on. It just seemed like there was a lot of drinking going on his end of things that maybe interfered with what the plans were for him to travel around to make that extra money and to do those funds. And that was pretty much all the relationship was. And by the time we came into George's life, it had totally subsided. We did get in contact with Christina. Me and Chris did go to her house and spoke with her on filming. So of course we could have her point of view. We didn't want anything to seem biased, only coming from George, but George never spoke ill of her in any manner. He just told us his side, which of course as documentarians is not our job to just film one side of anything. So we wanted to give her her time, but unfortunately it never ended. The stars never aligned on that.
One thing you learn with our documentary is that George had a stepdaughter. Mirtha had a kid before him. Huh. And during all this, what was cool with getting with her is she was old enough. She was 10. She was old enough to realize what was happening with this. Talks about being on flights with Pablo and Carlos later and George and serving them drinks and them giving her $100 tips. Christina was young. She didn't really understand anything. She didn't know anything until she was way later in life. And George is already in prison. Yeah. So we did get the stepdaughter who, you know, George treated her like his own. She had just everything that Christina would have had if he hadn't, you know, kept going with the outlaw life.
So George passed away in May of 2021, correct?
Correct.
When was the last time you guys spoke to him before he died, and what were like his final words to you?
Wow, that's a heavy question. Me and Chris spoke with him a lot. There was a moment where he was pretty much comatose, so it would be these little anecdotes and these little stories and these little, you know, every time he spoke, it was so poetic. It's really crazy because he was highly intelligent, as you can well imagine, to pull off all the things that he did in his life. You know, you reach this point in your road where if you're kind of have that genius thought process where you go this way or this way. And George could have been a poet. He could have been a literary master in multiple ways. But so I would say for me is, you know, he just told me to pretty much keep on my path, and that how proud of he was of me, and how blessed he was that we were a part of each other's lives. And I'm pretty sure he was telling George or telling Chris the same things. I don't know if there's anything that stood out, but all of our talks were very heavy and very prolific, and very much he knew that his time was coming, and that he was happy that he lived his last years of his life with us, and he was happy that his story was getting out to the world the way that he wanted it to be. You know, we never told anything in a negative light. So,
So when all is said and done, this is a 5-part series, correct?
Yes.
When all is said and done, after people watch this, what's your hope? What do you want them to walk away with after watching Boston George's life?
You know, for me, I kind of started this out with, you know, he's not that cocaine cowboys carrying a gun around, kneecapping people, acting like, you know, he's some big tough guy. You know, we wanted to show that, you know, he had a lot of struggle in his life. He lost a lot of women. He lost a lot of friends. You know, he's such a sensitive guy. And you can tell that from interviews with Johnny Depp, from the DEA agents who busted him. They all loved him. You know, they continue to, you know, talk about him in a positive light, his friends, his family, maybe not his daughter, but, you know, that's between them of what actually took place. But, you know, he's just so fun to talk to. We have so many interviews that are so lengthy that didn't make the documentary that you could just put it online and people just sit there and listen to him. Wow. Very captivating.
Hmm. Well, let's end with two final questions. One, tell us two or three movies that really inspired you guys to get in the filmmaking industry, like, you know, movies that really resonated with you, movies that may be off the beaten path, may not be off the beaten path, that, you know, really, like, said, I want to do this with my life.
Blow. I'm just kidding. Yeah, definitely. Blow for sure was always up there. For me, I was always off the wall, like Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, because again, that's just Hunter S. Thompson at his finest. You know, I grew up on Westerns and Clint Eastwood and The Good, the Bad, the Ugly, things along those lines. So luckily me and the outlaw lifestyle really stayed linear.
Cool. How about you, Chris?
You know, I've always been in that storytelling. I don't really watch science fiction. It's anything that was involved in a true story. I've always been a documentary, you know, fan. There's a lot of really good ones out there, and I'm not talking about like Tiger King. I'm talking about like really good stories. So, like in particular, but you know, back when George or Georgette called me and goes, "Do you know who George Young was?" Yes, 1,000%. I knew his name. And, you know, it was one of those, I've got to be involved and just tell that story. So for me, it was just, it's more of that true story vibe that I get more than animation and Star Wars. That, you know, they're I'm sure they're great movies. I just don't watch them. So this kind of stuff, you know, when you watch stuff about the Beatles and guys who actually change society or you know, music or any of that. I mean, even down to drug smuggling. I mean, he was a business guy and he said, you know, I would have sold potatoes if they were $60,000 a kilo.
Mm.
So, you know, like I like true stories. I like real life stuff.
Mm. Lastly, you know, if people are just so captivated by this, they want to learn more about you guys and want to learn, how can people get in touch with you too?
Through our emails and through our Instagrams, right, Chris? That would be the best.
Yep. We have it's G2C Productions. So G2CProductions.com. Our Instagram for the series is Boston George Young, J-U-N-G. You know, we share a lot of little small stories, but we're about to share a lot more. Things are starting now that we're, you know, we're Fandor and we're excited to do that. We're looking forward to developing a podcast so you can get more in depth. Like I said, we have 70 terabytes of stuff and even 5 episodes doesn't even come close to getting you the really good stories that didn't make the cut. So, yeah, check out G2C Productions and Boston George Young on Instagram.
Excellent. Looking forward to that. And here's the kickoff to your podcast.
Right? Yeah. We're kicking off your podcast.
Yeah, exactly. All right,
Georgette, Chris, we wish you nothing but the best. And everyone, please check out the Boston George docuseries on Fandor. It's going to be available this week. So hopefully our paths will cross soon, you guys. We wish you nothing but the best.
Thanks so much.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah. Awesome. Bye, Brian. Thanks.